Hey, Folkland, we got a reminder from our friends at NHTSA. If you're ever stopped at a railway crossing, the signals are flashing. Maybe you don't see the train. Maybe it's looking slow. You're thinking, I'm going to sneak across these tracks. Think about this. Even if the engineer sees you and applies emergency brakes right away, it can take the train over a mile to stop. By that time, it's too late. The resulting crash will be deadly. Stop. Trains can't.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Oh, no, Jason.
Oh, yeah, baby.
Welcome in, the Fantasy Footballers.
There is a lot of confused listeners, and there is one very confused host.
I don't know if this is good or bad for the Foot Clan, because Tuesday, November 3rd, welcome in. Jason, I was concerned, would not really be present of mind today, because I see him, as the show's starting,
type,
because he's working on trades for our League of Record. Because, you know, I made some trades this morning, and Jason's got to try to keep up. Got to
keep pace with those teams behind me that are trying to catch me, you know? So,
yeah.
Would that mean you're slowing down?
Yes.
Oh, interesting conversation piece, Mike. I would not like to keep pace.
But apparently, as the show began, I was going to call him out for his, you know, absent-mindedness that was on the way, and instead, he fist pumped and he got a trade done.
I got the official accept the moment that our intro music started. It was fantastic, and it was with someone in this room.
Ooh,
Owl Borland.
Oh, you sneaky!
So we'll let the Foot Clan know what I did. I made a trade of a third rounder in next year's keeper draft for Thomas Brady.
Okay.
Quarterback. I'm all trading right for a quarterback because I believe that Brady has the chance to go nuclear. When Godwin comes back.
Sure.
When Antonio Brown is on the field with Mike Evans and Gronk, I think there's a chance he could go full nuclear.
I feel great about that trade.
Yeah, right? You were
as your division mate.
Super into 279-2. That really did it for you.
279-2. Wait, he had Godwin?
When's Godwin coming back?
Did he have Antonio Brown?
Nope.
Okay, well, add those two in, and I would say that makes a difference.
We have a waiver show today. A lot of important decisions to make for your fantasy football teams in your own leagues where you're making your own trades and doing your own thing, and we're going to help you out. We've got the quarterback streamers on today's show as well. Some news to get into. Injury tilt is upon us. And, guys, it's Tuesday. It's a big day because the NFL trade deadline is today.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
Oh, that is a big day.
Which is 4 p.m. Eastern. So you could see, I mean, the names that are thrown out there consistently, which means nothing will happen with them probably, is Will Fuller, David Njoku, Golden Tate.
Stephon Gilmore has been added to the mix.
Yeah.
Well, I will say, yeah, you know, like 5 years ago, all these names would be thrown out and nothing would happen. The last couple of years, though, moves have started to be made.
Is that our fault? Is this a fantasy football related trend in the NFL? Jason setting the precedent as the show opens?
Yes. It could be. Or teams are wising up that you could trade a low pick in the draft and get a known veteran and make your team better right now. I have no idea what took the NFL so long to figure this out.
As opposed to the low pick that has a probability of being good, these players are already good.
No, we're not giving you our fourth rounder. We've got like a 15% chance to get a starter there.
And then it's like, well, no, I don't want to give up a pick and get this guy. What if he walks away and we get a nice compensatory pick for our loss?
Yeah. Hey, here's what I will focus on. We've had some discussion on Will Fuller. Would he be successful? You might be speculating about these players and where they are going. Here's what you should be thinking about. Here is the next level 4D chess move for your fantasy league. What does their absence represent on the team that they're leaving? If Will Fuller leaves, mm-hmm. are you suddenly grabbing Randall Cobb from the Waiver Wire, who also could be traded, or Brandon Cooks. You know, what does the absence of Golden Tate represent for Darius Slayton and Sterling Shepard moving forward? Those are opportunities that people don't think about to pick up, you know, and it's the waiver show. So someone like Sterling Shepard will bring up today.
Or Ingram. My man finally got 10 targets.
Oh, man, nobody looks worse getting 10 targets than Evan Ingram.
Even when he makes a great play, that was he was so athletic down the sideline. Great catch, running out of bounds. Fantastic.
If you could get the ball in his hands and just avoid watching him try to get it there, it's all good, right? He's fast, he's athletic, but it's hard to watch the two or three ugly drops where he tries to catch the ball with his the back of his hands. I don't
Is it
understand.
Because he's surprised that the ball is there?
Yes.
He's like, all surprised. Oh no, this isn't usual.
Daniel Jones was summed up in that last drive. I mean, a couple of fourth down, big throws, a couple of uggo passes. Amazing throw to Golden Tate, late ball to Deion Lewis. Debate whether it's PI or not. The truth is the throw was bad because he didn't throw it earlier.
The only reason it was PI was because he threw it behind the guy, and the receiver had to basically stop and go backwards into the defender who was playing great defense.
Probably shouldn't reward bad passes in the NFL. Even though I think that was technically PI, I think it's probably the best thing to do is to pick up that flag.
Yeah, Daniel Jones is the new Mitchell Trubisky. He is not a franchise quarterback. You can see it right now. He will never be a franchise quarterback. And that's me calling my shot. He'll have his decent games, including this week, 6 touchdowns, now that I've said that. But I don't think there's any chance that he is a legit real quarterback. He looks too lost sometimes. It's like he's guessing with pocket presence. He just scrambles to the right thinking there's people coming from the left. He's running right into Ndamukong Suh like, oh, this is nice. I'll just tackle you.
Yeah, tremendous physical skills, but it hasn't come together. And to finish off the recap for last night, you know, you saw Alfred Morris make an appearance, which is never a good sign for your backfield.
No.
Leonard Fournette took over after Ronald Jones fumbled, which is exactly what happens in this offense because Bruce Arians, he exists in a universe of either 8 out of 10 angry, 9 out of 10 angry, or 10 out of 10 angry. He only goes down to 8. So when you are on edge...
He does go to 11, to be fair.
You're right. He does go to 11, which is super dangerous for his heart.
It's just shades of pink or red. Yes. That's all it is. You just look and say, how red is he right now? Oh, he's just regular, red.
He's tomato and tomato for Bruce Arians.
A delight on Valentine's Day.
Yeah. But you might say, wow, Leonard Fournette has assumed the role. You are wrong. He could have the role this week. He could also not. And Ronald Jones could have the role and he could also not.
Yeah,
don't fumble if you're either of those guys.
I don't think there's clarity in the backfield there. The one place that I feel confident in clarity is with the wide receiver that I believe is just the best wide receiver for the Giants, Sterling Shepard. He's kind of been a Golden Tate-esque player right now, or a Jamison Crowder-esque player. You've got 8 targets last week, 10 targets this week. The Giants are usually going to be in a game script to need to throw the ball. And while Darius Slayton gets those deep passes that he's – when those connect, those will be bad games for Sterling Shepard because the drive is over and all the fantasy points goes to Slayton. The reality is I think he misses those more than he hits them. And more often than not, Sterling Shepard's going to be a really solid, not spectacular, but solid fantasy option rest of season.
Kind of reminds me of what happens in Chicago where they take 3 or 4 shots to Mooney, and Mooney we expect to break out, but they never – Robinson's the one you want to have in that offense. Here's the question mark, and we'll put a bow on this game with it. You talked about Brady. Now, Brady, it doesn't matter who he throws to. He gets the fantasy points. But he completed passes to what looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different receivers yesterday. And that is without Antonio Brown. That is without Chris Godwin. Brady is best when he is kind of receiver agnostic, when he is just willing to throw it to whoever's open, wherever they are on the field. Tyler Johnson getting opportunities. Jaden Mickens getting opportunities. Gronkowski was great again. I will throw that out there. This is three straight weeks with a touchdown, so he's a viable tight end. But is it going to be very difficult to predict which week is the Brown week, which week is going to be Godwin coming up? Evans got into the end zone. Without that play, it's a dud week. Tyler Johnson showing up, Gronkowski showing up.
It's tough because Antonio Brown is such a wild card at this point in my head of we've seen him one time with Tom Brady. It was off the street. It was limited snaps. And Antonio Brown got a whole bunch of targets. Now, they kind of talked at length on the broadcast of how Tom Brady was the one who was actively campaigning for Antonio Brown to go to the Patriots. And we know that he actively campaigned for him to go to Tampa Bay, despite Bruce Arians going Hufflepuff with his chest.
This is my team.
I made the best decision for the team. This has nothing to do with Tom Brady. Nothing to do at all.
Did he mean to throw Hufflepuff out there?
I did. Huffle and Pufflin.
Oh, okay.
It was just...
It's a Harry Potter reference.
That's right. That's right. The Hufflepuffs are secretly mean. This is what people don't really
do not know that.
That's the weakest of the houses.
Yeah.
It's a big secret.
That's what you think. But once Antonio Brown is there, if he's still anything resembling Antonio Brown, he will be the one that is open. I think that Mike Evans doesn't get a bunch of targets because he's never wide open anymore. He wins the contested catch, but Antonio Brown is going to be wide open all the time, and he might emerge as the top target. Now, does that mean 8 receptions or 4? That I have no idea.
I'm coming around on the consistency potential for Brown, especially with Godwin's re-injuries. And
right.
Evans is just not – there's something about the Evans-Brady connection that's not, you know, what it was with Jameis.
Yeah, I think he's – Evans is used to just a ball 40 feet in the air, mm-hmm. giving him a jump ball situation, and coverage doesn't matter. And Brady's like, get open. That's how it feels.
Well, and when Evans was open, Brady missed him on that deep shot.
Yeah, you're always going to have that chance. I mean, that's the nice thing. And anything else from the game last night that you guys want to mention before we move on to news?
The offensive line for the Giants looked a little bit better than it had, and Wayne Gallman was better than expected against this Tampa Bay defensive line. He wasn't great, but if Devonta Freeman comes back and the offensive line is starting to gel a little bit, maybe there's some hope for decent fantasy production.
Maybe. They play Washington this week, and Washington's defensive line is very good.
Just 8 carries to Alfred Morris makes you feel
so weird.
A little bit queasy.
So weird.
But I guess they didn't want to give Gallman all the carries.
I guess.
All right, let's talk news.
News and notes from around the league.
All right, this is unfortunate. In fact, we have several players dealing with injury. George Kittle is going to miss 8 weeks, has a broken bone in his foot. If you could see Mike's face.
It's not good.
It's representative of the injury. It is it's unfortunate. This is a team now that has been just beset by injury after injury. Jimmy Garoppolo is going to be sidelined indefinitely. I can tell you right now, they're not bringing that guy back unless his ankle is extra fine, because when they brought him back early, he looked awful. Now, there are many out there that believe Nick Mullins is a better quarterback than Jimmy Garoppolo, including many San Francisco fans. So, no George Kittle, no Debo Samuel, likely this week, no Jimmy Garoppolo. Suddenly, Brandon Ayuk is he's a 10-target guarantee. But the offense, you know, you don't have running backs right now either. You don't have Raheem Mostert. It's very doubtful that Tevin Coleman would come back.
My name is Jeff.
You don't have Jeff Wilson. No, and this game is Thursday. So I would expect no Debo, and I would expect no Tevin Coleman. So you're talking about Jamichael Hasty and Brandon Ayuk against Green Bay.
Yeah, and the thing is with Green Bay is they are as bad as it gets against the run game. So you want to get Jamichael Hasty in there. We'll talk about him. He's probably, you know, already rostered in every single league out there, but it's a weird situation. And while I do think that Mullins might be better for fantasy. The team does not win with Mullins. If you look at the record of the 49ers with Garoppolo and without Garoppolo since he's come, this is a very wide sample size for NFL purposes. The San Francisco 49ers do not win games very often without Jimmy G, and certainly without George Kittle. It's going to be I think both these guys could be done for the year, barring them making the playoffs and coming back for a playoff run.
Yep, that's a good point on the game script too, and how it's turned out with Beathard or Mullins. Kenny Golladay, hip injury. He's expected to miss week 9. When I saw the quote from Patricia, he chose to say, "Yeah, it's more of a day to day or week to week thing."
You know, it's one of those month to month. Who's supposed, counting?
But they're choosing to work out Mohamed Sanu, which is a sign that Kenny Golladay will not be there, and that you are desperate. And you know, now you are looking at Quentin Cephas. You're looking at Marvin Jones, another player that could be traded before the deadline. Danny Amendola. My favorite of the bunch is TJ Hockenson, because you've had back-to-back top 5 weeks for him. It's very difficult to know what you're going to get from Golladay moving forward. He missed a couple games earlier this year. And
what do you do with Stafford? I mean, Stafford finally showed up.
Without Golladay. I mean, Golladay was goose this past week.
Right. He finally showed up. Marvin Jones had the 2-touchdown game. He has a solid matchup here against the Minnesota Vikings. We'll talk streaming quarterbacks later, but is Stafford one of your guys' streamers? You feel feeling confident still playing him?
Confidence and Matthew Stafford do not go together, but the matchup and the fact that he did it last week, he did it the week before with over 340 yards, and then he did it last week without Kenny Golladay. I mean, Golladay had 0 fantasy points. Gives me confidence that he can exploit a good matchup when he's put in the position to throw the football. And it'll be, you know, it'll be Marvin Hall. It'll be Amendola. It'll be Cephas and Hockenson and Swift. And A.J. Dillon tested positive for COVID-19. He's going to be out. Now, here's the big news. Jamal Williams is a close contact to A.J. Dillon. So he is not allowed to practice. There is a chance he misses the game.
Yeah, being that it's Thursday, the high-risk category for close contact usually has a protocol that means he's a legit chance to miss. You're going to need Aaron Jones back for this game, Green Bay. Do we have any updates on Aaron Jones' health, or is it still just questionable?
I think it's still up in the air.
I would be looking at this the same way that we saw Christian McCaffrey last week. You're not willing to risk the future for the present with Aaron Jones, and yet you're in a kind of a pickle at running back. But you get 10 days if he misses this game. You get 10 additional days. If he's not out there, you're looking at, right now, Tyler Irvin, but he's not going to carry the load. They have a practice squad running back, Dexter Williams, I think, who's on practice squad. Those would be your running backs for Thursday.
And Tyler Irvin was questionable on Monday with limited in practice.
Oh, my goodness. Davante Adams is going to see 20
Where's
targets.
Where's DJ Dallas when you need him?
Huh.
Yeah.
Wow.
So maybe that, I mean.
Have we ever seen a team.
Just running back?
Not even no running backs. No runs. 100% pass. They just come out. Here's our game plan. We're throwing every play.
John Kuhn's phone is ringing. That's what, somebody's calling him. Hey, you free?
Can't get in by Thursday. That's the thing with COVID is the COVID protocols mean they cannot sign someone
John
right
Kuhn's
now.
John Kuhn's hanging out down there all the time. He's got nothing to do.
But, you know, as far as passing the protocol, we've seen this a couple times this year. You can't sign someone and have them ready by game day.
All right. There was the official word from Frank Reich that Jonathan Taylor has a bit of an ankle issue. A
little bit.
Bit of an ankle issue and a bit of a Baltimore Ravens matchup this week. Are you just OUT on Jonathan Taylor?
Oh, man. It would be nice for fantasy football if Jonathan Taylor got a week of rest here. And, I mean, if you are desperate, then you could play Jordan Wilkins against the Baltimore Ravens. But this is, we will be following the news throughout the week. I might be OUT on playing Taylor this week.
I know I'm going to try to avoid it.
Yeah.
Austin Hooper will definitely be back in week 10.
All right.
It's big news for the Browns. Mm-hmm. And then Sam Darnold's MRI showed an aggravation of a previous shoulder injury. He's going to attempt to manage it and work through it. Poor soul that he is.
Yes.
And we'll keep you up to date with the trade deadline. Before we get into the waivers, we want to thank today's sponsor. This episode of the Fantasy Footballers is brought to you by Head and Shoulders, available at Walmart. And this year, you've been following along. We've got the new segment every Thursday, picking our up to 100 players of the week. So it's time to reflect.
Yes.
Briefly, Jason. Briefly.
Mike won.
I don't know.
On Mike's victory last week. Brandon Ayuk took it to 100 even before the touchdown. Ayuk was taking it to 100 player. AJ Green twisted the knife in my soul. And Denzel Mims, he took the first quarter to 100.
Oh, man, that first quarter, he was great. And then it's like, don't throw to him anymore.
What are they doing?
I don't know, man. It is like if you followed a recipe for losing.
What did he have, like 45 yards in the first quarter?
2 for 42 in the first quarter. He received, I believe, one target the rest of the way.
What are you doing?
I don't know. You're
trying to hit 10 points on the dot every week. They're trying so hard.
Man, they really want a number one pick.
So that evens Mike and I up on the year in terms of the taking it to 100. I think Jason is just a pick behind, if that is correct. You can take your hair up to 100 with Head and Shoulders, available at Walmart. Pick yours up today and check out this Thursday's episode to hear the up to 100 players for this week.
I figured it out, fellas.
Okay.
Mims had 42 yards in week 7.
Yeah.
And then he had 42 yards in week 8.
Oh, so he hit his cap.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes more sense.
He just was, I got it. I've done what I need to do.
Yeah, once you hit your cap, you move on to Berrios, because you know he can't hit the cap. What
is
it, Berrios 46 have, receptions for 14
unlimited.
Yards?
Yeah, I think Berrios' line was something like 8 receptions for 38 yards. It was so Braxton Berrios.
Yeah.
Yeah, 8 for 34.
Wow.
Oh, I gave him 38. My apologies.
That's impressive.
4.2 yards per catch.
Wow.
That's fun.
When you can't run with Frank Gore, you want to accomplish nearly the same by throwing. Wow. All right, waiver time.
Put me in, coach.
All right. Gentlemen, we are heading into week 9 of the NFL season. Returning from the bye, Washington, the Cardinals, Jacksonville, and the Texans. And then heading to bye, the Bengals, the Browns, the Rams, the Eagles. All right, wide receivers, it is time to get into it. And there are, you know, this is the point of the year, too. You know, Mike brought it up way back when, one of our tips and tricks. There are times that you are, you know, you're breaking the season up into chunks. Mm. You're trying to buy wins. I know some of my trades today, they weren't necessarily long-term moves. I would like to have the problems of start sits in the playoffs versus, you know, only looking to the future and not making it. So I made a move for Chase Edmonds in one of our leagues. So you got to buy weeks. And in waivers, it's an opportunity with matchups. Now, drop candidates from Twitter. People want to know, should I let these players go? And I know the disclaimer, it's all based on who you're picking up. But let me ask it a different way. Are you willing to drop DJ Chark, CeeDee Lamb, or Marquise Hollywood Brown?
I am willing to drop Lamb. I would not be dropping Marquise Brown. DJ Chark is, he's an unknown at this point. You just hold on to DJ Chark, see what the rookie can do, gluten-free. What he can do for Jacksonville. But DJ Chark is still the number one receiver on the team. I would expect for Luton to lock onto him.
Yeah, I think all three of these are worthy. If there is someone on the waivers and you need a win and you're more confident in them, that's fine. Personally, DJ Chark and CeeDee Lamb, I'm okay moving on. Because not because of them. They're both very talented wide receivers. But when you've got, you know, a quintessentially third string NFL quarterbacks, there's not going to be fantasy production to be had. If he's the one for the team, I'm not sure I want it.
Yeah, it makes sense. And then Hollywood Brown came out on Twitter chirping.
Yeah.
About not being used.
What tweet? As he deletes it?
And oh, he deleted it?
Oh, he deleted it, but it's everywhere, obviously.
It's the internet. Still learning what the internet does.
But the squeaky wheel could end up.
How do people not know this?
Well, it's not that they don't know it. It's
a reaction.
Yeah, it's an
Twitter's
emotional
too close.
Thing. I mean, it is frustrating. As someone who has Hollywood Brown as my guy this year, I still love what I see on the field. I haven't seen him do anything that makes me believe less in the talent. What sucks and what I've had to come to terms with is that Lamar Jackson throws for 200 yards a game. And while I wanted it to go up this year, and week one looked great, 275 yards, 100 yards for Hollywood in the first half, he averages 200 yards a game. And he did that last year, 208 yards a game, as the MVP. It's not going to change. He's not going to go out and throw a bunch of 350-yard games, and the pie's just too small for Hollywood.
Yeah, I mean, if you go back, if you get the MVP season, you still get the infrequent success of starting Hollywood Brown. All the hope and optimism in the world, but you're still dealing with a player that is, like you said, cutting a small pie, and, you know, it wasn't great last year. I mean, over the last 8 weeks last year, he had a couple good games. So it sucks. It sucks because we know that the ability is there.
Mm-hmm.
But he's certainly more of the DeSean Jackson mold. And even in DeSean Jackson's heyday, even in peak DeSean Jackson, he wasn't somebody that you got consistency from.
Yeah, I mean, you can start Marquise Brown this week and next week and the next week. You could start him every single week because he has the ability and the chance to just take a long touchdown to the house. But you can do that with, you know, Henry Ruggs.
All right, so let's look at the options, though, because there's not a standout to me. There's not a you must get this guy at the expense of all other wide receiver options. There's a lot of speculative potential, and maybe Sterling Shepard's at the top of that list with the fact that, you know, 10 targets, 8 for 74, you get a baseline. You get red zone work, right? He had the touchdown the week before. And if Golden Tate leaves, it clears the, you know, mm-hmm. wide receiver core a little bit. And I do think that's a pretty strong possibility that Golden Tate, because I don't know why you would hang on to an aging Golden Tate.
Who's, yeah, but I don't know who would
yeah, who's
trade
been linked
for Golden,
to
Tate.
Golden Tate.
I don't have teams that are linked to him. They just okay. have the name out there. They've right. seen it reported. And it makes perfect sense to me. I mean, he is a great ad for a veteran team. And we saw this happen 2 years ago. Golden Tate moved at the trade deadline to Philadelphia, making the Super Bowl run. So to me, if I'm a veteran team, you know, if I'm Aaron Rodgers, I probably want Golden Tate just as much as I would want Will Fuller on that roster. Still a good player, man. He doesn't really drop the ball ever.
Yeah, he's not bad. But Sterling Shepard, he's only available in about half the leagues out there, but he is available in 50% of the league, so go check. He would be my number one, but I'm not paying up for any of the wide receivers this week. I think that there's a handful of decent options. Sterling Shepard would be my number one because he projects to be the one for his team, and he's a really solid wide receiver. Outside of him, I think it's a bunch of crapshoots, matchup plays, things like that this week, and when I'm scrolling through the list of names and trying to find someone that I really like, that is widely available. Talk me out here of Henry Ruggs, because Henry Ruggs has done really nothing in his rookie year outside of one decent game. But I, for some reason, I look at, you know, them. He's back. He was injured, and then it was a weathery game, slate and snow and
slate. Wow.
And at one point, wasn't it hailing? We're watching.
It was Slayton. It was Sleeton. It was Slootin.
We're watching hail in that game, but the schedule upcoming says you could throw him in those lineups and you could probably get a big game one of the next few.
I think he's probably the same as Hollywood, which is not necessarily a recommendation.
Yeah.
Would you prefer Brown or Ruggs?
Well, I guess I would prefer Ruggs.
All right.
But not by much, and I don't know if I really prefer either. I mean, this is a – if your team needs a boom potential and you've got a lot of, you know, stabilizing forces on your roster, that's the situation where Hollywood or Ruggs, I'm excited to put him in my lineup.
Well, let's throw one other name in there because it's very same archetype, which is Mecole Hardman, who finally had a week of involvement. Do you buy in? Are we buying in and saying, look, Sammy Watkins isn't healthy enough yet – and he was out there and heavily targeted. Can we trust that Mecole Hardman is taking a step forward, or was that an anomalous one-off game?
I like the pie size in
Kansas
City. I mean,
that's a huge pie.
You've got a dependency on Derek Carr, which is not great. in Las Vegas, and then you have a small pie in Baltimore. At least with Mecole Hardman, you get big play potential and 400 yards that are on the table potentially. So I would prefer Hardman, and then I would prefer Ruggs, and then I would prefer Hollywood.
And then I will throw the name Marvin Jones, who is available in about half of leagues coming off the 2-touchdown week.
That's tough, man.
Minnesota.
Yeah, I mean, you probably.
No Kenny Golladay.
Yeah, you probably have to play him. He's just, even in this 2-touchdown game, it was 39 receiving yards. It's just not been pretty. But, yeah, I would be willing to. You know that's where Stafford's going to look.
In the first 2 weeks, because that was Kenny Golladay missed the first 2 weeks, right?
Yes.
Am I remembering that?
Or, so, well, he played in, yeah, you're right, first 2 weeks.
Week three, Arizona, Kenny Golladay showed up. So those first 2 weeks, 8 targets in week one, turned into 4 for 55! Then week two, 6 targets, 4 for 23. He did have the touchdown. So
Minnesota's a great matchup.
So the great matchup, we've seen 3 games essentially without Kenny Golladay. 3 touchdowns in that time span. I think Marvin Jones is a decent play if you're trying to grab someone off the wire for a 1 week rental.
Yeah, I think he's probably going to end up around 50 yards, but if you want to take a shot at someone who could have 2 touchdowns in a game, yeah, Marvin Jones is at the top of the list. Would you rather take a flyer on one of those deep ball players we just talked about, the speedsters, or the 1 week without Kenny Golladay knowledge of the Minnesota matchup, would you put Marvin Jones ahead of those guys?
I'd go
Marvin.
I'd play Hardman. Yeah. It's tough.
And then in a deeper league, unfortunately, we don't know his injury status, but Tim Patrick from the Denver Broncos is matched up against the Atlanta Falcons. Again, I don't know his injury status, because he would be in the mix here for me as well.
Let me throw something else out there for fantasy players that don't need to buy a win this week, that yes, need to look longer yep term. If you are not maneuvering for a pickup this week only, I would be picking up Jalen Reagor.
Yeah.
I think Reagor would be at the top, tippy top of my list. Has the bye, not going to cost you a lot. Teams are out there maneuvering for a win, and this is a very talented player that is going to be targeted on the reg by Carson Wentz. So that's where I'd be looking. I'd be trying to add him to the roster as he gets healthier through the bye, because you're going to get a couple deep shots to him every week.
Yeah, I think Reagor is a great speculative add for the future. I also think that Alan Lazard from the Green Bay Packers is a great stash at this point. We kind of forgot about Alan Lazard because he went to IR. We didn't know how long he was going to be out, but he's practicing. He practiced multiple times last week. I don't know if he's going to be back this week, but Alan Lazard has played 3 games this year, wide receiver 13, wide receiver 5. So Lazard was showing up as a reliable target for Aaron Rodgers.
That'll be a trade deadline. I wouldn't be, you know, you're putting him in by the end of the day. We'll see what happens at the trade deadline too.
Sure. Yeah, you'll have that information by the evening to put your waiver claims in. But Reagor and Lazard, I think, are my longer term adds to strengthen your team moving forward.
Yeah, I like all that. The last name I would throw out there, he is probably rostered, but because he was 1 reception for 4 yards 2 weeks ago, he might be dropped in on waivers. It looks like he's available in half of the leagues, and this might be my number one guy, would be Mike Williams.
Number one guy.
Mike Williams has been awesome. He's just a great wide receiver. And Justin Herbert has been fantastic. The matchup this week is great, and 2 of the last 3 games, I know there was that 1 reception for 4-yard game, but that's a sandwich. The bread is delicious in this sandwich. Top 10 wide receivers.
It's a pumpernickel sandwich
on both sides. So
you a pumpernickel fan?
He has the talent.
You don't like pumpernickel?
No, I do love.
Yeah, pumpernickel's like pumpernickel.
I went with that because
you hate rye.
Oh goodness gracious! Why do people eat rye bread?
I think because it's bread. See, what I've learned is that bread is really good.
It is. All bread is great except rye bread.
And all bread is bread, and that's really the key.
Bread is bread, man.
Well, unless you're overseas at Subway, in which case it's not legally bread. Yeah, that's cake.
Was that Ireland?
Yes.
Do we know that if a player is traded today, right? Can they play in this upcoming week, or do they have to go through like a more formal COVID clearing on the way through?
I believe, let's see, it's Tuesday. I think they would have to miss this week.
That's kind of how I'm feeling too.
I mean, definitely for the, you know, we've been bringing up the Packers, right? Who's their wide receiver too? There's no chance that they could trade for a player and have him get
this
in by
another
Thursday.
Reason I want Will Fuller to stay put. I don't need another buy for Will Fuller. Stay put, buddy. Trade Randall Cobb.
All right. Lots of wide receivers that are all okay.
Yeah, right. Are we ready to move on from these running backs? Lev Bell.
No.
Joshua Kelly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mike Davis.
No.
No.
No? Why said with such disgust, Jason? That was like Mike eating rye bread.
Mike Davis has cemented himself as a true insurance policy. While he hasn't been as phenomenal the last couple weeks as he was in the beginning, even if Christian McCaffrey is back, I mean, this is like saying Alexander Mattison and Tony Pollard, and he's one of those names where I'm going to have him rostered already, no matter what. It's not saying that you can start him, even though he's, you know, been promised a little bit of involvement. You can't start him when CMC's back, but he needs to be rostered.
Okay, but let's give it some context. Because I agree with the sentiment, but let's put it into reality with someone like J.K. Dobbins. J.K. Dobbins looks great. J.K. Dobbins represents a potential league-winning type of situation if he gets this kind of work on a regular basis. You would, if you're not the CMC manager, you're dropping Mike Davis for J.K. Dobbins.
If you're not the CMC manager, yes. If you are the CMC manager, then no.
Is there another running back that you would drop Mike Davis to pick up this week? Philip, would you do it for Philip Lindsay, who's absolutely the same Philip Lindsay as ever? Would you do it for Zach Moss?
Zach Moss, perhaps. I mean, context is absolutely needed here, but trying to buy wins, let's say you're 4-4 or 3-5. You got to get that win. I would be willing to do it for Jamichael Hasty against the Green Bay Packers.
Breaking news.
Ooh.
Jamal Williams is officially out.
Oh, brother.
Whoa.
Oh, brother.
So if it's not Aaron Jones, it will be Tyler Irvin, Dexter Williams combination.
Oh, my goodness.
Which is good timing in terms of looking at the running back waiver wire. Let me throw some names out there for you. Tyler Irvin and Dexter Williams. Now, you're facing a formidable defensive front on Thursday Night Football. It feels like you're going after the Wayne Gallmans of the world here, right? Like, the opportunity is more – is Rodgers running through the air type of
– Yeah. It's not really
exciting.
I mean,
Irvin is a pass-catching back.
Yeah, he was limited. I mean, I lean Irvin as the pickup from the Green Bay Packers squad, but I'm not going after everything.
That's
crazy. I'm not throwing it all out there. But it was so Jamichael Hasty, he gets to play Green Bay. I would be very happy to play him against that defense.
No question. Jamichael Hasty, if he's still out there, unfortunately, he's the last man standing for San Francisco. And fortunately for him, only 29 yards on 12 carries last week. This was not the Jeff Wilson experience, but he did score twice. I don't know if you're going to have any running backs blow up on Thursday, but it would be Hasty above the rest.
How do you feel about Jerick McKinnon, Andy, in this match against Green Bay, who's terrible?
About the same way I feel about Jerick McKinnon the past 2 weeks when you guys looked at me flabbergasted. I he's going to have an opportunity. He had 4 catches last week, so he's not going to get handed the football. They're not going to have him run it. It's like starting James White.
Sure.
Nick Mullins has to throw the ball to Jerick McKinnon. If that happens and you get lucky and he gets in the end zone, then you're happy. But that's how I feel.
If we're projecting the game out, Mullins versus Aaron Rodgers, Mullins without his top two pass-catching weapons,
sure.
I would game script this that San Francisco is going to have to throw the ball.
Are you starting McKinnon or Hasty?
I'm starting Hasty.
Yeah, I would start Hasty over McKinnon, but I think both are startable assets this week.
You think that every week, no matter what.
It's worked out most weeks.
Yeah.
Okay. That's not true.
It's not? You should look at his game log.
It's not true for Jerick McKinnon.
For Jerick McKinnon?
Not since the injuries.
Jerick McKinnon has been a running back two or better in 5 of 8 games.
Yeah.
That is more often than not.
But one of the last 4. I think
fair.
That's more
interesting. My point is they came out and said tired legs, they won't hand him the football. He was 3 for -1 on the ground. It is a risk, gentlemen.
Oh, yes. Certainly is a risk.
It is a risk. That's all I'm saying.
So is life, Andy.
Yeah. Fantasy football is let me tell you about this risk I'm really in on. His name's Tevin Coleman. You ever heard of him? Other running backs worth considering. Are you actively pursuing Jordan Wilkins? Are you concerned that this wasn't just injury for Jonathan Taylor? Because if you get Jordan Wilkins this week, you get Baltimore. You get Jordan Wilkins in a timeshare against Baltimore.
He's a $0, $1 at the end of my waiver priority. That if I miss out on everybody else I'm going after, I can put Wilkins in.
No,
maybe.
Yeah,
maybe.
Yeah, for me, there's no way I'm playing Jordan Wilkins. 0.0 chance. I'm not even putting in a $0 bid because while he was great this last week, he was. Give him his due. Detroit opened the holes and said, run on me. And he's broken tackles and fantastic. Great job, Jordan Wilkins. The rest of the season, he's been atrocious. He's looked terrible. I can't imagine a world just because Jonathan Taylor's banged up that he doesn't look terrible against the Baltimore Ravens in that unbelievable defensive line. So I am OUT on Jordan
Wilkins. Is Hines the running back that you'd want to start in that game?
No.
If I had to pick one, if I had to pick one, it would be Hines because I think he's – it goes back to last week talking about the Baltimore Ravens when we picked – J.K. Dobbins is the one because he's got the game-breaking ability, and I think that if one of those two guys is going to break something, you know, a wheel route for a touchdown, we've seen it a couple times, I would take Hines, but I would start nobody.
Here's a depressing stat. Jordan Wilkins, who you said has looked atrocious, has avoided 16 tackles on 49 rushing attempts. Jonathan Taylor Thomas has avoided 7 tackles on 100 attempts.
Mm. And your rebuttal?
My rebuttal is that it's an indictment on Jonathan Taylor, not an endorsement for Jordan Wilkins.
All right.
It's a significant Jonathan Taylor might not be what we thought he was. Because he hasn't been what we thought he was.
It's
getting a lot of Trent Richardson comps lately.
Oh, don't do that.
Yeah, I mean,
don't throw that
Trent
name
Richardson
out
was
there.
What, the number 3 pick in the draft?
Yeah.
Oh.
Look, there's a clip going around on Twitter of him running into the back of his lineman. It reminded me of Trent Richardson.
Yeah.
With a hole, a gaping hole on the side. You talked about the defense opening up holes for Jordan Wilkins. I believe that is the exact same defense that Jonathan Taylor was playing in that game.
Sure.
11 for 22.
Okay, so it sounds like we're not very interested in the Colts running backs. What is going on with your interest in Seattle? They get to play the Buffalo Bills, who you can run on the Buffalo Bills. We don't know what it is. DJ Dallas came through with a big fantasy week. Pretty inefficient, but he was the guy who got everything. Are you going to do any potential stashes of DJ Dallas or Carlos Hyde? Hyde had the hamstring. He was ruled out pretty quickly. But if Carson misses and Hyde is in, I mean, you got a lot of algebra you got to do here to figure out who the
$0
starter is.
$0 bid.
Okay, but you would still put the zero in?
Yeah,
are you talking for DJ Dallas?
For DJ Dallas, yeah. That's what I did last week. Ended up with him. Didn't start him, Tevin Coleman. But it was it's too hard of a situation. I expect one of these guys to play, Homer, Hyde, or Carson.
Homer played, but they said we would prefer DJ Dallas over Travis.
Well, he was banged up though. So yeah. I'm just saying, like, one of these guys is going to be ready, right?
And Carson
was
be
so
ready to
close
go.
To playing this last week, and it has been playing through injuries. I expect Carson back. That's why I agree with Andy, a $0 bid, because if Carson was out, I think DJ Dallas is going to be a fine play, but I don't expect Carson to be out, so I'm not prioritizing DJ Dallas here. The
Cam Akers?
Potentially.
We need to talk about him, yes.
Yeah, let's talk about Cam Akers, the injury to the thigh of Daryl Henderson. The Rams
but the thigh's on the bye.
Mm.
Oh, it's on a bye this week? I'm not going in on Cam Akers then. Because that gives time for Daryl Henderson to recoup, recuperate, and Daryl Henderson.
Whoa, that is a new word.
Did I say recuperate?
You did.
That is a brand new
word. Yeah, man. That was awesome.
He's going to recuperate and recoverate.
Oh, man, it's been a while.
That sounds like an awesome drink. Let's go in on this, fellas.
You want to start
a new sports drink?
A new sports drink, recuperate. Are you kidding me? You tell me, what do you want to do? You want a Gatorade or you want to recuperate? I need to recuperate. I'm out here working
I know what
hard.
It does.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What's a Gator do besides try and eat me?
I thought that was the name of the other drink. Gator do.
Recuperate and recovery.
Gator do and recuperate.
But prior to Daryl Henderson going down in that game, he looked outstanding as he's looked. You know, in his opportunities. So
it reminded me of the W.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah. That was perfect for today.
No, the player that I, so I'm out on Cam Akers going into a bye. Do either of you disagree with that?
Yeah, I do. I would add Cam Akers.
I think Cam Akers is worth a stash. Yes. Okay.
Well, let me put the name, against it. I was going to bring up and see who would you rather pick up. I was going to talk about Damian Harris, who has been pretty good. I mean, he looks good. They're wanting to run the ball. They can't pass because Cam stinks. Now the Patriots offense as a whole stinks. The touchdown opportunities might not be there, but since he's came back, you know, he missed the first 3 weeks. In the last four games that he's played, he's had two games over 100 yards. He's, you know, been involved and looked all right.
I'm interested.
He should be rostered
in a spot start. What is so brutal about him is 2 weeks ago against San Francisco, 40% of the snaps. That's the highest he's seen on the year. Even in his monster game against the Buffalo Bills, 31% of the snaps. It's not a number to chase that a guy who's getting 31% of the snaps is going to see 16 attempts.
Now,
against the Jets, I think you can play him. Yeah.
That was going to be where I went. Can I entice you by the New York Jets?
Of course you can.
If they start shipping out their defense, see more James White on the field.
Even if they don't. Oh, the Patriots, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Can we talk tight ends?
Yep.
All right. Tight end drop candidates. George Kittle, you're letting him go 8 weeks. See you later.
Yep.
Jonnu Smith compared to Dallas Goedert, for example.
I'd rather have Dallas Goedert, yes. Okay, but he is on a bye week, so no, I retract my statement.
Okay.
Because you'll get 0 points from Goedert.
Well, yeah, which, but you could pivot to somebody else for a week and have Goedert and use him rest of the season.
It's funny because I think the two main pickups this week on waiver wires are fellas you can't play this week. This is the week where you're going to pick up Dallas Goedert and you're going to pick up Austin Hooper. Mm-hmm. Those are two known commodities that are going to help you at the rest of season stretch if you're having struggles. Let's say you're the Jonnu Smith guy and he's just stunk. I would hold on to Jonnu Smith and pick up a Dallas Goedert or Austin Hooper and go from there. You bide your time for a week, and I think both of these guys are going to be good plays the majority of the games the rest of season.
All right, pickups for this week then, Jason. Who are you targeting to start?
Oh, man. There's a handful of players. The names that come to mind are Logan Thomas, Trey Burton, and Evan Engram.
No Jordan Reed?
Well, Jordan Reed would be fantastic if I knew he was going to be out there. We've got Rule 81. If he is healthy and activated and George Kittle is not, then you play Jordan Reed. But
is he fully recuperated?
I mean, we got to ship him some recuperate immediately.
It's powerful stuff.
I mean, yeah, you don't drink it. You pour it on the wound.
The timeline says that he could.
It says do not drink on the bottle. I mean,
not for human consumption.
Right.
Yeah, the timeline.
It's radioactive.
He could return for week 9, but I don't have any more information than that. And it's hard to.
He's been asking to practice. I think he practiced last week. Shanahan says it's been impressive on his recovery. It's worth throwing out there.
Absolutely.
That you want to start him on a Thursday, but I mean, Jordan Reed, rest of season?
Sure. Yeah, pick him up.
I mean, is he a better play than Dallas Goedert? Probably not, but he could be.
I think he'll get two or three. I'm hoping for two or three really good games before the injury to Jordan Reed. So I don't know if he can make it rest of season. He's never been able to do that.
Trey Burton, 4 for 48, had the touchdown last week. It's a couple nice weeks in a row. You could do a lot worse.
Yeah, it's tough against Baltimore, but they are using these tight ends as Philip Rivers does, as Frank Reich does, and Trey Burton, I think, is say what you want about the size of Gigantor and the
he's huge.
He is huge, and the history of Jack Doyle, but I think Trey Burton is the best of the three tight ends.
It is it's murky once again in tight end land, but those are some potential starts. Austin Hooper's on bye.
Yeah, I'm with Jason that Hooper and Goddard are, if you are looking long term, and this week if I'm picking somebody up to play because my tight end is on bye, whatever, it would be Logan Thomas or Eric Ebron. Eric Ebron from the Steelers gets to take on the Dallas Cowboys.
Oh, that's mighty nice.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm so excited. I have the Steelers defense this week.
Yeah, I've got the Patriots defense this week. I'm very excited against the Jets.
Well, if you don't have one of those, let's talk about some other defenses you can start. The Texans are at the top of my list.
Sure.
They are playing Jake Luton and the Jacksonville Jaguars. And the Texans, who knows, they may ship some players out before the deadline today. But I love starting defenses against rookies because rookies look like Ben DiNucci. And that's great for defenses.
Yeah, there's actually a lot of streaming options this week at the defense.
Cardinals.
I like Houston. I like the Cardinals against Tua. I get it. If you just look at the box score of what happened, you go, holy crap, the Dolphins dominated. Well, their defense absolutely manhandled the Los Angeles Rams. Kyler Murray's a very different quarterback than Jared Goff, who just stands there and gets hit. Kyler Murray will not be doing that. So the Arizona is very interesting, and Washington is very interesting against the New York Giants. Daniel Jones turns the ball over, and Washington is one of the best teams in terms of pressure rate against the quarterback.
Yeah, Packers Thursday night against San Francisco with Nick Mullins. They're probably not going to do a ton on offense in that game, so that's another option as well. And the Titans, who have shored up their secondary via trade a little bit, take on Nick Foles, who makes mistakes as well.
Real quick to just add on to the Cardinals, I think they're a great play against the Dolphins. Mike, do you know how bad the Dolphins' offense was? Do you know who the leading receiver for the Dolphins was?
Oh, my gosh. Okay, so Parker had the touchdown.
Jakeem Grant, maybe?
Jakeem Grant was 1 yard behind the leader. The leader was Durham Smythe with 16 receiving yards.
Oof.
That was the leader for the entirety of the game.
Let me just transition that into, are you actively shipping Devontae Parker out as fast as possible with the touchdown he lucked into last week?
100% shopping Devontae Parker, yes.
Okay. Let's talk quarterbacks.
Full stream ahead.
All right, every week we're bringing you a streaming quarterback option outside the norm, right? Outside the every week starters, somebody that we say, hey, the matchup says this could be a week. You have bye weeks. You have injuries. Mike, you and I are choosing from the same game, so I'll let you go first.
All right, I'm going with Kirk Cousins, quarterback of the Minnesota Vikings. He is taking on the Detroit Lions. We have a 53-point over-under. That is juicy. It is at home for Kirk.
No weather.
Yeah, not weathery. Not weathery when you're indoors. And Detroit has been beat several times by fantasy quarterbacks, including most recently by P. River himself in the Indianapolis Colts. Phillip Rivers ended up as the quarterback 7. And just a couple weeks ago, I mean, you had Gardner Minshew against this team. So Minnesota and Kirk Cousins, I like him.
Well, in the same game, I'm gonna go with Matthew Stafford against Minnesota. They've given up a top 8 performance in every one of their games.
It's a 53-point over or under.
Yeah, it's the same story. I hope we're getting the game that we think we're getting with that over under.
Yeah. I hope so.
And you know, he did it all last week and finished the number 3 quarterback without Kenny G. It's a bit of chasing, but you know, in the streaming quarterback area, proof of concept is kind of important versus going, you know, with somebody that you haven't seen do it. Stafford has started to look a lot better.
Yeah, and my guy, I'm going to be honest, I love my guy this week. I'm very confident in my pick.
Really?
Yeah, and it might be...
Send in the car.
Yes, sir,
send
baby.
In the car.
I really think Derek Carr is a great play this week.
I know you do because you brought Henry Ruggs up so soon, earlier.
Yeah, I just... The matchup is great. If you look at what was happening with the Raiders offense, I wanted to love Derek Carr last week, but that insane weather game, you know, the Did the game reach 10 points total between both teams?
I think it was like 3-3 at halftime or 6-3 at halftime.
Yeah, I mean, it was an insane thing. But the two previous weeks, you had Derek Carr as a top 12 quarterback. Now in a matchup against the Chargers with Justin Herbert, who I think is going to keep up again, the shoe will drop, but I don't believe it's going to be this week. And so this to me, with Ruggs, with Aguilar's kind of potential breakout, Waller.
I'm excited for you to say that in week 16. The shoe will drop. It's not going to be this week, and then we'll just be out of the season. We'll be out of games for the shoes to drop.
No, I already said when it was going to drop.
When is it?
Let me look. I think it's next week.
Okay. All the reasons you talked about, Carr, all the reasons I believe I made on my stream last week before we got word of the weather being so disastrous. So,
yes,
there's good potential. You know when the shoe's going to drop?
It's the following week against the Dolphins.
Okay.
That's when the shoe drops.
Okay.
And Mike just sits back and waits for it to drop.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know anymore. All right. We want to thank Pristine Auction. A signed Devontae Parker jersey, $55. Yesterday, use the code BALLERS at pristineauction.com. We're going to be doing some cool giveaway stuff around Christmas time with Pristine Auction. And we have a giveaway right now, right, at footclangiveaway.com for a Kenny G jersey as well. That'll do it for today's show. We'll be back with you tomorrow morning. Have a wonderful rest of your day.
Stay safe, everybody. We'll make it through. See you tomorrow. Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter at the FFBallers.
Foot Clan, remember our message from NHTSA. If you're ever stopped at a railway crossing, the signals are flashing, you don't see the train, maybe it's moving slow, just wait for it to pass. Remember this: if the engineer sees you and applies the emergency brakes right away, it can take the train over a mile to stop. Over a mile, the resulting crash will be deadly. Stop. Trains can't.